Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the Adventures Club Hiking Webinar Mountain Rangers. I will be your OC for today, and I'm from Adventure Club. I'm part of the Adventure Club committee, and for those who are in the Adventure Club will know that our club's mission and vision is to just enjoy and relax. That's why we have made this event so that we all can enjoy and understand the basic of mountain climbing and hiking, and so we know how to go to hike in the future after the pandemic has been completed. So now I'll be introducing our speakers for today. Firstly, Joanne, who is a hiker from Malaysia. She has a total of 6 years of experience, and you can follow her on her Facebook, Instagram, and also subscribe and like her videos on YouTube. All the names for the social media page. I'll just give a few seconds for you to see and so you can know the speakers for today. Okay, next will be Vector Chong. He is from China, but is currently based in Singapore, and these are his social media pages. Since he's from China, he'll be most active on WeChat and Xiaohongshu, but you can also follow him on his YouTube page called Seven Adventure. I'll give you a few seconds just to screenshot this page so that you can follow them on social media later. Now, let me introduce the moderator of today, Eric.
Hello, guys. I'm Eric. Okay. So before we start the webinar, let me introduce myself again. My name is Eric from Adventure Club. I will be responsible for the moderator for this webinar today. And before I get started, I would like to go over a few items. First, all participants are required to stay till the end of the webinar to scan the QR code for the sign-up form for the ELE. Secondly, please remember to take a screenshot of the webinar with your Facebook profile for your ELE report. Next, you will have your opportunity to submit text questions to the presenter today by typing your question in the comment section at any time. We will collect this and address them during the Q&A section at the end of today's presentation. So for today's webinar, our speaker will be sharing their hiking experience and will also answer some questions regarding on hiking. As I said before, there will be a Q&A section later, so if you have any question to ask our speaker, you can type your question in the comment and we will try to answer them later. So, for like what Joyce just now had said, let's introduce our speaker. First is Joanne, and another one is Vector. Okay, so let's dive into the question. Okay, so for question one, so for our first question, what's the reason to begin hiking? Joanne, may I hear it from you first?
Hi, Eric. Yeah, actually, back to 2014, I was actually inspired by a friend's photo on Facebook. Yeah, it's a picture of him and his buddy standing in the mossy forest. So I have never seen that in the city. So I was so excited to find out more. So until there's one day, he tagged me along to that place. It was a long day hike to me. Yeah, the trail is full with mud, and wow, the scenes really looks like we are in the Lord of the Ring. That's how they describe it, and I totally agree with that. So I've been addicted to the beauty of nature since then, and yeah, from there I started my local and overseas hiking trip until now.
Oh yeah, interesting. So Joanne, you mentioned about mossy forest, right? Is it the one in Cameron Highlands? Can you tell our participant more about your first hiking experience?
Yeah, there's the famous mossy forest in Cameron Highlands. I think most of them actually heard it before. So that's my very first hiking experience. So actually, I didn't prepare much. So I just wear a short pants and then a cotton shirt. And then I just bring a limited food and waters. So actually, they told me I just need to take 6 hours to complete. But actually, we take it 10 hours in total, because we have a weak stamina, we didn't training much, and then we dragging a lot of time on photo shootings, and then actually there's a raining on the way back, and then plus there's one friend was actually punctured. I mean, he cannot walk anymore at the end. And then he's a bit laid back behind. So we actually wait until 9 o'clock in the night. And then plus raining, everyone was squeezing in the bondock, you know. So the cold wind blowing, and then we try to keep warm hardly, and then we almost get cold. That's really unforgettable, actually.
Wow. Interesting. Okay, Joanne, I noticed in the presentation slide, there's three photos here, right? 1, 2,
yeah.
Three.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, can you tell our viewer what is the location of these three places so they can know more about it?
Yeah, the top left one is a Phun Hill. It's one of the Nepal's most popular trekking routes. So it's also a hill station that can overlooking the Annapurna Massive Range and the Dalgari Mountain Range. So this place considered an easy trek that's either for beginners to wishing to explore the Himalaya.
Mm. So what about the other two?
The bottom left, is a last rest house. I take this photo at the last rest house before ABC, which is Annapurna Base Camp. And then the Snow Mountain is actually Annapurna 1, the 10th highest mountain in the world. Yeah.
So the left one with your friend?
The right one is at Gunung Dahan, which is the highest mountain in Peninsula. We are standing above the cloud.
Oh. All right, thanks, Joanne. What about you, Rector? What is the reason that you began hiking?
Yeah, hello. Good morning. I'm so glad to have this opportunity to share with you all of you my experience. So I think before I start to share you the reason, so let me introduce myself a bit. So actually, I'm a software engineer. So besides the full-time job, and I'm also a scuba diving instructor. So other than the hiking, I think I know in Malaysia there are a lot of beautiful places for underwater as well. So if you like to know more, you can also I can also share it later. So what is the reason for me to begin hiking? For me, right, I like to travel all over the world to see the different sceneries. So taking photo and video is my hobby, so it can record my every moment of my life. So you can see the picture of the left. It's called Bromo in Indonesia. So actually it's the first place I started my hiking. So same as Joanne, when I first saw this picture from my friends, so it will make me, wow, this is a really amazing place I would like to go. So after that, I just planned the trip then with my friend to explore the Bromo. So other than that, the Yijing is beside the Bromo. So actually it's just a 3 days trip. Then you can just take 1 day leave then plus the weekend, then you can just go. So this the so hiking, I think, is one of the way I can explore the world, as some of the beautiful place can only be reached by while hiking. So yeah, this is the reason I started.
Oh wow, thank you. Vector, I noticed that you said the left one is from Bromo. So what about the other two from the right side? The right two photo.
Yeah, the top right is from Kinabalu, which is in Malaysia as well.
Mm-hmm.
The bottom right is from Kumano Goto in Japan.
Oh, interesting. Yeah. So is there any interesting story of your first hiking? So when you go your first hiking, any interesting story?
Yes. So for Bromo, right? As is my first hiking as well, so the Bromo actually is not very difficult, as you just need to take the jeep just toward the Bromo. So after that, right, you will ride a horse. So I knew ride a horse, then it's I think it's really interesting for me to ride.
Okay, thank you, Rector and Joanne. Okay, so now moving on to the next question. What inspired people to begin hiking? What do you guys think? Joanne, can I hear from you?
Yeah, sure. I think just like how I being inspired, I think it's the nature scenes that you can't always see or experience in your daily life. And then, of course, the fun and interesting trail, the big tree, the crystal clear river stream, the greenery, the little creatures, wonderful flora and plants, especially mushroom though. Actually, there are some people who are into it. They actually hunt along the hike, taking some nice photos and sharing them across the social media. So, and of course, the satisfactions when you reach to the peak, enjoying the beautiful view at the top, relaxing your mind and forgetting all the tiredness. So, although it's always a tiring journey, but your mind and your soul always got recharged. So there's also some history or legend about the mountain, and somehow it's quite interesting. So hiking is a kind of ecotourism to me, I think, where you can explore the beauty of nature with friends and family and then sharing the good times in your life.
Oh, so Joanne, do you hunt any of those things? You know what you said, like mushroom, all those? Do you, when you go hiking, do you hunt for all those things?
Yeah, actually, I will. And I will also take photos if I still got energy. Sometimes you can find some special species, and well, it's considered collections to me. Yeah.
So if our viewer want to see, where can they see?
They can go to my Facebook or my blog. Yes.
Oh, okay. So if you guys want to see more, can go to Joanne Facebook and blog to see. Yeah. Okay. Thank you, Joanne. So how about you, Rector? What inspired people to begin hiking?
Yeah, for some people around me, right? I think some of them stay at home day and night. Then suddenly they have a mind that I want to go out to do some fitness. So I think some of them start hiking for fitness purpose. So some of them would like to relax up or take a break, reduce the pressure after a long walking hour or study period. So some of them, I think, same as me, looking forward to meet some beauty of the nature and taking the picture and video. So also for hiking, right, you can enjoy making friends and having fun with a group of people. So once you begin hiking, these are some of the reasons I think it will inspire you and make you enjoy the whole journey.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so Rector, do you have a group of hiking buddy?
Yes, actually I have a lot of hiking group. Other than hiking group, also diving group. So from for Chinese, right, we usually use WeChat. So I think we create a lot of different group for different purpose. So I think one day this weekend I want to go hiking to this place. Anyone want to join? Then I think there are a lot of people who like to go.
Oh, wow! So just as Joanne said, he will go like hunt for all those more of drag like mushroom insect. Rector, will you do that too?
It depends. Yeah, okay. If. Mushroom, I never tried, but I hear some of people try it.
Okay, thank you, Rector. So how about you, Joanne? Do you have any group of hiking buddy? Like what Rector had a group of hiking buddy, they will go hiking together. How about you?
Yeah, when I start join hiking, I actually has a group of friends which is consistently go to hike like every weekends. Yeah, then after that, I make a lot of friends during hiking. And then until now, after a few years, I can actually join anybody who I know to go hiking now, can easily form a group to go anytime I want. Yeah.
So you guys will plan together and go different places and hike, lah. So
yeah, usually just like very last minute, shall we go to hike tomorrow? Then we can just go because we are quite close and then we are quite experienced as well. So we can just 说走就走 like that. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Thank you. All right. So we know that. Okay. So we know that Rector and Joanne, you both have a lot of hiking experience from what I heard from you guys. So would you like to share some of your past hiking experience with our viewer here so they can know more? So Joanne, you first.
Okay. Yeah, as I mentioned before, I started hiking on 2014. So until now, I have a 6-year experience. So accumulatedly, I have done about 80 hills and mountains in Malaysia, no matter big or small, high or low. Okay. And then I there's some memorable one in Malaysia, which is like Mount Kinabalu in the pictures at the left. Is the highest mountain in Malaysia. I done it on 2017. And then the right-hand side is the Gunung Tahan, which is the highest mountain in Peninsula. It was a 6-day, 5-night expedition, and also my first G7, which is the G7 means the 7th highest mountain in Peninsula. Yeah, and then the Gunung Tahan is the first one. And then for my overseas trip, there's a few memorable ones. And then, yeah, the slide. Okay, yeah, just now I mentioned the G7. Here is the four of them. Four among the seven. The Gunung Kobu is the second one. And then the Gunung Gayong is the fourth. Gunung Yongbela is the third one. And then the Gunung Semanggol is somewhere in Selangor. It's not in G7, but which is a beautiful panoramic view.
Okay. So, So what about overseas? Do you go to your overseas past experience, past hiking experience?
Yeah, of course, there's a few. Like I said, the Annapurna Base Camp on the left is a mature and beautiful trekking trail in Nepal. We took about 10 days to complete. And then the right-hand side is the Mount Fansipan, which is the highest mountain in Vietnam. We took 2 days, 1 night. Actually, Mount Fansipan is a tourist place also. You can naturally go up by cable car, but we are hikers, right? So we choose to hike up at the first day, and then we're coming down by the cable car at the second day. So it's a quite interesting experience. Yeah.
So, Joanne.
And then, yeah, there's some more. Okay. The third one is the Mount Rinjani in Indonesia, which is the second highest volcano in Indonesia. It took 3 days, 2 nights. And then some people actually done it like 2 days, 1 night, or even 4 days, 3 nights. It depends your stamina or how you want to explore the place. And then the right-hand side is the Mount Pulag. It's the third highest mountain in Philippines. I complete it in day hike, and then it's during Christmas. So it's very cold weather.
Oh, wow. Okay, so Joanne, you said about G7, right? You said G7 is the highest the top seven highest mountain in Peninsula, right? Correct me if I'm wrong. But only in Peninsula, it's not in the whole Malaysia, right?
Normally when we mention about G7, it's talking about the seven highest mountain in Peninsula. And then sometimes we will say G12, meaning the 12th highest mountain in Malaysia, including East Malaysia and West Malaysia. So I think last year, 2020, they actually explored another two mountains in Borneo, Sabah, Sarawak there. So actually making East Malaysia and West Malaysia also have G7 now. But still, until now, commonly when we mention about G7, it's still pointed to the seven highest mountain in Peninsula.
Oh.
Yeah.
So, okay. So, okay. So, this trip photo is also from your past hiking experience, if I'm wrong. Am I right?
Yeah. Okay. Yes, 1, 2, 3. The top left one.
So I noticed in the top left you're sitting next to a pile of metal. This is very strange for me, because this is the first time I saw in a mountain there's a pile of metal suddenly, it's like a trash or something. Is there any incidents or tell us where is it and what is the pile of metal?
The metal that you see is a plane crash site in Gunung Tahan, actually. It's a wreckage of an aircraft. So it's located between the Gunung Tahan peak and the Camp Gedong. So it's actually back to 4th of May 1972. There's a firing officer, Lloyd Smith, from Australia, crashed while conducting an individual radar navigation exercise. So it's a tragedy, actually.
Oh, so the photo with the lot of moss, is it from your first hiking experience? Because I think it's from mossy forest, right?
Yeah, there's a mossy forest. Can you see? It looks like a lot of the ring scenery. And then you can notice that I actually wear a very short pant, and then it's like very lamp shirts and some backpack jacket like that. And then the bottom one is actually the Starry Nights at Annapurna Base Camp. Actually, there is Milky Way, but then you can't really see in the picture because there is a moon behind me, actually. Yeah.
Okay, so Joanne, do you have any interesting story to tell our participant, like some unforgettable story in your hiking experience?
Yeah, there's one. There's one in Gunung Dahan, unforgettable river crossing at Gunung Dahan, because we need to cross 7 times to the river during the hike. So there was a heavy foot after it rained overnight. So we packed our stuff in the morning and then we queue up, try to cross the river. And that time the river looks like teh tarik. We can't really see the riverbed, which is full of stones and rocks. We can't really stand still when we're crossing. So when we are trying hard to work to the halfway, and then suddenly one of the team members was stuck in front of us, and then he actually caused everybody get stuck in the middle of the river too. So we try to hold up our hands with each other or hold up with the hiking stick to stabilize ourselves. So we couldn't stay long actually if the situation remains. So luckily the mountain guide, he knows something wrong between us, so he come and help us. He's very strong and full of experience. So I still remember when he tried to transfer me to the shore with a big branch. So actually that time I can really feel my lower body was once floating in the water. I cannot even touch the riverbed. And then the strong current really made me panic though, because I'm going away from the current. And then, but finally I'm safely to get up to the shore. So this is why we always strongly encourage people to engage a mountain guide, even though to Mount Gunung Dahan is a must. And then they're normally orang asli living nearby the mountain, so they know more than us. Yeah. Mm. So what can we do if we really get stuck by the flood? So we have to try to keep warm and wait until the flood gone. Usually it takes like a few hours. Yeah, or maybe longer. So always make sure you have sufficient water and food storage. And then extra food supply is always required when you go for a long hike. So worst to the worst, you can call Bomba to help due to the situations. Yeah.
Oh, thanks. So do you have any others unforgettable story?
Yeah, there's another one slightly terrible in Gunung Semangkok, because I think most of the experienced hikers would have heard about some mystery story or scary story in the jungle, so same to me. But luckily, I never encountered any until the hike at Gunung Semangkok, which is located in Fraser Hill. The Gunung Semangkok, we call it Siwangku in Chinese with its direct translate, meaning direct
valley of it.
Yeah. Okay, it's a direct translation from the word. So it itself is not scary, but the challenging trail does scare some hikers away. So it was a long day hike, cost me about 18 hours in total. We hike from the dawn to midnight. And then there's a legend that's saying there's the stream near the campsite called Sungai Merah will turn into red at the night. And then some of them actually heard a lot of footsteps around the tent during camping. And then some also saying that they saw little girls hanging around the resting point. So all this scary story actually, wow, quite freaking out. Okay. So when we reached the peak and headed back to the trailhead, our leader told us not to stay long while you're passing to the campsite, which is the Sungai Merah that I mentioned just now. So we just stopped by and filling some water, take some rest, and then we leave before the day goes dark. Okay, then that time suddenly the wind started to blowing. We supposed to be glad or for the chill, you know, because when we hike we always feel hot. Yeah, but then I starting to hear someone is whispering around the jungle. I'm not sure actually, but I just feel panic and anxiety and told myself, focus to the trail. There shouldn't be somebody there. It's just maybe some sound from the forest, from the leaves or anything, movement. So we just try to pass through the area. And then luckily, we just safely arrived at the next checkpoint. So after we go through the part of the trail, everything went back to the normal. And also I didn't see any legends, little girls along the way, thank God. And then safely back to the trailhead in the end. So maybe you can't feel the panic by listening it, but when you are there, you definitely will.
Oh, a little bit scary, So I think when we climb high mountains, maybe we should listen to what they said before we climb. Because I think I heard some people said when you climb the mountain, don't shout name or something like that. Is it true?
Usually we don't purposely call up our team member by name. Usually we will come out some sound. We can create some sound. Like sometimes when I call my buddies, I will call meow. Or maybe woo like that. So when they heard you, they will know where is your location, or maybe they can kind of slightly estimate how far are you or the distance between you and him like that. So we just want to make sure we are around, and then we are stick to the trail. Yeah.
Oh, all right. Thank you, Wagner. How about you? What are some of your past hiking experience?
Hello. Yeah, as what I mentioned, right? So Bromo and Yijun is the first place I have been. So I think let me introduce this trip. So for Bromo and Yijun, it will be a 3 days trip. So it's not too much hiking for Bromo, as you can see from the left side picture. So you will take the jeep going to the Bromo. So after that, right, at the bottom of the Bromo, you will ride a horse. Then you can see the next slide. So by riding a horse, you will go to the middle of the volcano. So you can see the right side picture. Behind me, you can see a very long stairs. So this only the way you will need to climb up to see the Bromo. So on the left side, right, it's on the top of the Bromo. Actually, the Bromo is the active volcano, so you can hear the very big sound from here. Yes. So after the Bromo, right, you will be going to the Yijun. So Yijun, you were taking a car, and then taking a rest in the afternoon, because from Yijun you may need to start to hike around 3 a.m. As you can see the left, why we need to start at night, because in Yijun you may want to see the blue fire on the right top. So you may start at around 3 a.m. It took around 2 hours to reach the top. So of course you may need to wear the mask, because the smog is bad for your body. So after the sunrise, you will be also seeing the beautiful the view, because it's on the top. So the mountain is quite high as well. So you can see the right bottom picture. There are a lot of Yunhai behind me.
Oh, yes. Okay. So other than Bromo and Yijun, is there any other more experience, past experience?
Yes, other than that, I also went to the ABC camp, which is in Nepal. So for me, like, Nepal is ABC is a 7 days trip for me. So some people may take as a 9 day trip or 10 days trip. It depends on you. You want to walk faster or slower, explore the place. So for me, 7 days is including the coming back. So it took me 4 days to reach the top. So what is the amazing place is up the last day after you reach behind more than 3,800 meter. So on the top is around 4,100. So when you reach the top, right, actually it's snowing. So for me, right, I never been seeing the beautiful place, beautiful view when it is snowing. So it's very exciting for me as well. So for ABC camp, right, you can see the bottom right. So you can see the golden color. So actually this the most amazing scenery for this whole trip. Yes, so you may need to get up earlier to see this sunrise. Actually, it's when the sun rises up, right? It will shine on the snow mountain. So it look like it's on fire. So the color turned to golden and the smoke also coming out as well. So when you see, I think it will make you also, wow, really beautiful. Then just take picture, video.
Wow.
So this for the ABC trip. So other than this, I also went to Kumanakoto. This is Kinabalu. Kinabalu, actually, I went there only last year. So before the COVID-19 happened. So this is the last trip I go to the different country for hiking.
Wow. Thank you, Vector. So, Vector, I heard that you got a few videos you want to share to our viewers to watch, right? Of your hiking trip.
Yes.
So, shall we watch it?
Yes.
Okay. Yes, let's watch it. thank you, Vector, for showing us your wonderful video. So before we move on to the next question, I've noticed that, Vector, you went to climb two volcanoes, Bromo and the next one. So,
Yijing,
yeah. So, Joanne, you also went hiking on Mount Rinjani, also a volcano. So, may I ask, is it actually safe to went hiking to a volcano? Because, volcano suddenly erupt or something like that. So, is it actually very safe to climb a volcano? I want to hear it from both of you. What's your opinion?
I will say there's always a risk for hiking, no matter volcano or any other mountains. But if the place is generally open to public, I think it's relatively safe, like the famous Mount Fuji, Rinjani, and then even Mount Bromo. So it's an active volcano, actually. So however, we wouldn't know when it's an eruption or earthquake that might be happen anytime. So I would say stay alert on the local news and get well prepared. Yeah.
Mm. Thank you, Joanne. How about you, Vector?
Yes, I think as long as the volcano is already open to the public, it's safe for you to climb there. So some of the volcano also, so it's also a dangerous thing, right? So in Bali, mm-hmm. there's also volcano that is closed, though, so it will not allow to climb the mountain. So if for some Baofa, then I think the flight will be closed as well. So,
So for those viewers who doesn't know Chinese, Ho San Pao Fa is volcano erupt. So I'm just doing the translation here for you guys to understand more easily. Okay. Yeah, thank you both of you.
So like Bromo, right? Even though it's active, but I think if you reach the top, you can just hear the big sound, but it's not actually like what we see in the video that really dangerous, a big big one.
Okay, thank you both of you for sharing your past experience and answering is it safe to climb a volcano. So in technically if you want to climb a volcano, we had to see the local news more about it. Okay. So if anyone want to watch more of Vector or Joanne for hiking photo or video, you can go to their YouTube channel to see more. Joanne's YouTube channel is Love Feeling, LUVFEELIN, and Vector YouTube channel is 7 Adventure. So now we are getting more into some of the questions for people who want to start hiking now. So for our fourth question, what should you prepare for your backpack for hiking? Vector, can I hear it from you this time?
Yes. So for the backpack, so it will depends on the place where are you going to and how long will it take, how many days, and what's the weather like. So I think following is the list that you may need to prepare, but don't need to bring everything in a trip. So it depends on where are you going. So for the waterproof backpack, it's the necessary. Then it's for you to store your item. So waterproof is quite important as some of the place may rain as well. So the trekking shoe or running shoe, so it is also a really important one. I think before you start your hiking, you buy one trekking shoe. So get familiar with it, so it won't suddenly unfit for your foot. So for some place, right, there's some mountain, right, the temperature will raise up around 4 to 6 degrees for every 1,000 meter. So you can imagine if you are coming up to a mountain around 3,000 or 4,000, the degree will become low. So that's the reason that you may need to prepare some warm clothing and sock, and the hat, the hand glove as well, the winter hat. So windbreaker is also quite important if you are going some mountain. So the windbreaker, right, is not same as what you you wear in is the different one, because the if the water get into your body, the of the cold wind brought into the clothes, it will destroy the layer of the warm air. So result in the rapid loss of the heat and the drop of your body temperature. So loss of your body temperature is a very dangerous signal when you are going hiking. Yes, we move on to the next page. So you can see, right, some of the trip, you can see we start at night. So the head course is the thing you need to bring on. And some climbing stick, it will help you to climb some mountain, so you won't fall down easily. So if you are same as me, right, you may bring a camera, but make sure you have enough energy to bring the camera, as the camera usually will be heavier. So also some medication, and if you are you have mountain sickness, you may need to bring some pill as well. So other than that, the water bottle of the which the hydration system we will explain later. So these the things we may bring it. So remember, for all these items, right, the total weight should not be more than 8 kg if you are hiking. So some of the place you can actually hire a porter to help you to bring this stuff to another to the next station. So they will go first, bring your stuff, then you just hiking with your by your own. You don't need to bring anything.
Oh wow!
So this, yeah, as a beginner, you can choose to hire the porter if required. Yes, that's all.
Okay, thank you, Rector. So, Rector, can I ask what is a porter? Porter is those people that help you carry the stuff up, is it?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So, and then another question for you is there any limit of clothing that you can bring to hiking?
Actually, it's not limit. It depends on how much you can bring and how is the weather like.
Ah.
So some places, right? If it's not so cold, actually you don't need to bring the warm water, warm clothes. Oh, yes.
Okay, thank you, Rector. How about you, Joanne? What should you prepare for your backpack for hiking? And what's the use of bringing all those things?
I will suggest, based on local hiking in Malaysia, something important. There's mandatory item that I listed here. Sufficient water and food, that's very important. And then customized emergency kit, which can put in some aspirin. This is to reduce fever and pain, to treat muscle aches and some cold or headaches. And then paracetamol, which is a common painkiller to treat the aches and pain also. And then there's some important thing is antihistamine. This is to prevent allergy, especially when you got bee stung. And then some personal medicine if you have any. So to prepare as well, the antiseptic wipes and plaster or bandage to treat the wounds if you got any. And then when you got leg cramp, you can use the oral rehydration stock or salt stick. So also we have to always stand by an emergency blanket. So this is to help you when you start by the throat or any unforeseen circumstance, like when you accidentally get lost or waiting for the rescue. This emergency blanket can help you to keep warm, and then it can be a shelter from rain or sunscreen, and then it can help you to the reflective film on the emergency blanket actually can send a signal to the rescuer as well. So make them easier to find you, if any. And then always stand by a headlamp also, regardless of day high or long high or camping, anything. So this is to help you have a vision in the dark. So also when in emergency, you can send a signal to the rescuer also. So always ready windbreaker or raincoat. This is why when you hike, you will get sweat. And then when you reach some peak or some certain forest or jungle, you will get cold when you have the wind blowing or maybe raining. Okay, so you don't want to get wet or get sick from there. So you can also stand by a tracking device and mobile phone to connect with the emergency also.
So is there any optional item?
Yeah. And then just now I want to add something for the tracking device, right? Something like GPS watch, also kind of a tracking device like Garmin Sunto. So when an accident is detected on you and then request assistance from a device, the Garmin device can actually send your name and location to your emergency contacts. But technically, you need to learn how to use it. And then for optional item, yeah, you can stand by some hiking stick, mosquito repellent if you're scared of mosquito, and then some snack and candy, okay? And then stove, food utensil if you want to cook, and then some extra clothes to change because you will get sweat, and then if you don't want to feel cold, you can change, okay? And then some plastic bag for rubbish, of course. And then a seal bag to protect some sensitive item like handphone, wallet, and then some other personal item like camera, cam, or drone. Yeah, if you can carry all this.
Okay, so, okay, can we go back to the last night, the mandatory item there? So Joanne, you said about mobile phone, right? I want to ask, is it mobile phone? Because I heard that hiking mobile phone, when you go hiking, the mobile phone line will be terrible and anything. So is it actually good, helpful, or good for the mobile phone to use as a emergency, to contact emergency?
Not to say good or not, but it's a must to stand by. Even though the line or network is quite weak sometimes in the forest or jungle, but you need, when you really got emergency, you need to try to search for the line and network to get help. Yeah. So always get a mobile device is very important.
So you have to save battery also, because I know you guys went a few days and everything.
Yes. Yeah, that's why we always need to inform our friends and family about our hiking activities so they will know where is us and then why we didn't come back. Then if they feel something wrong, they can take some action immediately. Yeah.
All right. Thank you. So just now, Vector, you mentioned about refillable water bottle, and Joanne, you mentioned about sufficient water. So this brings us to our fifth question. What hydration system should be used for hiking? Joanne, can I hear from you?
Yes, okay. Normally when I go hiking, I will bring a water bladder and water bottle. Okay. For water bladder, because the design is very convenient, you can actually put inside your backpack and then save some backpack storage. So the advantage is easy access because it's convenient without stopping for drinking. It's a piping from your backpack, then you can just drink while you are walking, okay? And then the good thing is your body absorption is better with a small sips of the waters. But the disadvantage is you can't really know how much the water is left because it's hide in your backpack. So you have to judge with your experience, how the frequency you drink the water or the weight of your bag. And then I will bring also the water bottle for spare because sometimes you can fill up your energy drinks like 100 Plus or Rebina, which is my favorite. So the empty bottle can actually use as extra storage, like to refill when the hiking trail has a waterfall or stream, you can actually refill the water. And then, but the disadvantage is you need to stop by for drinking because it's a bottle. Then it's a bit bulky, and then sometimes it wastes the storage space also, and a bit heavier also compared to the water bladder.
Okay, so one question. What energy drink you recommend for the most for hiking? Because you said Ribena 100 Plus, which one is you recommend the most?
Depends on you. Sometimes people will bring Cokes also. As long as, yeah. I think Ribena is my favorite because I like the sweetness. And then sometimes I will mix some water also.
Okay, so another question, Joanne. How do you actually judge how many water you left in the water bladders? Because you said it's judged by experience. So how do you judge it?
I can say this can only just based on your own experience and drinking habit. Because some people that can control and drink less during the high, but some people that cannot have to drink a lot during the high. So I actually train myself to drink less. So that's why before hike, we have to study the information about the hill or mountain elevation, the distance, the duration, or is there any water station or water point along the trail? So you need to prepare accordingly. So I will say, let's say if you go for a duration, a hike with a duration like 4 hours, let's say this time when I go, I just drink like 1.5 liter. Of course, I will bring extra, like maybe 2 liter or 2.5 in common. But after I done the hike for 4 hours, I just drink like maybe 1 liter. So I will know next time I can judge from this experience. So from the way you have more experience, then you can know how you judge the water, the leftover of the water in your water bladder. Yeah.
All right.
So usually I will have a lot left over usually, but when you really not enough, and then yeah, then you have to gonna get help from your team member, or you need to find a water source.
All right. Thank you, Joanne. So how about you, Better? What hydration system should be used for hiking? What is the one you recommend the most?
Yes. So I think it's same as Joanne. So she had already explained the advantage and disadvantage. So the left side one is the hydration better as explained just now. So for me, right, I like it is because of it won't take too much space when you're drinking, right? The water go out, then the bladder will become less space. So it's also easier and convenient for you to drink the water, as you don't need to actually take out the backpack or for the drinking. It doesn't like the water bottle, you need to take out them drink. So it's very convenient for you, just use the drinking tube. So other than this, right, I'm on the left, on the right side, my friends, this the another different type of the bladder. So actually it's also won't take too much space, as you drink the water, the space also will be
so
if it is full water, right, after you move half of that of the water also it won't move here and there. So if you are going for running, it's also a good thing you can bring along.
All right, so there's different type of hydration bladder, if I'm gonna say.
So for water bottle, right, actually it depends on the place I'm going to. If some place is really cold, so the water bottle can help you to bring some warm water or hot water, so it can keep your body warm as well.
Mm. Okay, thank you, Vector. So just now we talked about hydration system. So we just talked about hydration system. So for our next question, let's talk about food. So what are the recommended food storage required for hiking? Joanne, what food is recommended?
Actually, to me, you can bring anything you like to eat and you are able to carry. There's no limitation to me. But commonly, I will suggest for short distance, short durations for about 4 to 6 hours, you can bring some light food, bread, pastry, cake, fruits, boiled egg or granola bar, something like this. And then for the long duration or long distance one, about 6 to 12 hours, you can maybe add on some heavy food, like some packed food like nasi lemak or noodles or even fast food. Can you imagine if you have McDonald's at the peak? That's quite cool, right? And then besides, if you have enough stamina and if you wish to cook, you have the complete cooking tools, then you can cook Maggi Mee. Always the best. It might not fill up your stomach, but it's really good when you have a hot food in the jungle. Yeah.
Okay, so Joanne, I heard before energy bar or anything, but I never heard before granola bar. Can you tell us more about what is granola bar is?
So granola bar actually is made of mixture of oats and other ingredients like brown sugar, raisin or coconut or nuts. So usually that's eaten as a snack. But some energy bar contains granola, and granola bar can be excellent source for energy during the day. So energy bar sometimes contain higher levels of protein, vitamin and mineral than granola bar. So depends on you. If you need more, then you can choose some protein bar. But to me, I like granola because it tastes good.
I see. So the photo now, the presentation now, this is your hiking set, is it?
This is my camping equipment when I go to Gunung Tahan, because it's a 7 days expedition. So there's actually quite a lot of stuff here. Yeah.
So you bring all those cats also? No, just kidding.
Yeah, I hope to bring them all actually.
Okay. So Joanne, one question. Is there anything that we should avoid when hiking?
Yeah, I will say there's always a reminder. So less spicy food before the day of hiking to avoid stomach ache. And then when you bring, if you bring any food to the hiking, so remember to bring down all the waste, including the food pill. So actually, a lot of people has a wrong thinking that the food pill can be turned into nutrition for the soil, but no, this is not okay. In fact, the food pill is not easy to be decomposed under the low temperature in the forest or mountain, and maybe because the problem with it will cause the problem with exotic species. Like moreover, if everyone keep thrown away, the speed of the pill decay is definitely slower than the speed of discarding. So eventually, the beautiful forest will become messy and full of the bad smell. Yeah.
Ah, I see. So all these photos you take one, in the presentation.
I have seen all this in the jungle. Yeah.
Oh, okay. Thank you, Joanne. So how about you, Rebecca? Any specific food to bring for hiking?
Yes, for high energy food, right, there are chocolate, nuts, biscuits with energy bar. So for me, actually, I bring whatever I like, but of course, whatever I can bring along. So it won't be too heavy for my backpack as well. So for usually for a short or long distance hiking, I bring the sweet as well. So Himalaya is a good brand of candy that we usually bring. So for some trip, right, like for example, for ABC, even though it is around 10 hours hiking per day, so there is a rest station for every 2 hour hiking. So actually, you can just buy something or refill the water in each station. So actually, you don't need to bring the water for 10 hours. Yes. So it can you just need to bring a little, maybe.
All right.
Yes.
So you mentioned about sweets and energy bars. I noticed there's a lot of sweet stuff here. So what's the purpose of all this sweet stuff when you go hiking? Joanne and Rebecca, you guys can answer this.
Actually, when you have a low sugar level in your body, you feel faint. So can some sweet things like candy actually can help. Or otherwise, just for refreshing also is good. Also, when you were tiring on hiking, actually. And then, yeah, what Vector mentioned just now, Himalaya salt candy is very popular for that. We always bring a lot of the candy during our hikes.
Okay, thank you, Joanne. How about you, Vector? Is it the same?
Yes, actually it's the same. So it will help you for the recovery.
All right. So we talk about food, we talk about that. So what are some of your future hiking plans after this pandemic? I know this pandemic like caused you guys a lot of plan to be canceled or postponed. So Joanne, what is your future hiking plan? Like in Malaysia.
Okay. So I mentioned just now, I have done my G7. I done 4 and then I left 3. So I wish to complete the other 3 as soon as possible. And then I need to keep exploring to any hill or mountain that I never been to, no matter big or small, high or low. I just want to check in and then keep building up my hiking list. And then for overseas, yeah, there is some bucket list. Like the EBC, which is the Everest Base Camp, because I missed the chance due to the 2019 because of the unstable financial. And then the Kashmir Great Lakes trek in India is a very beautiful lake in the valley. And then Mount Fuji in Japan, the snow mountain in Japan, yeah, very famous. And then the Gunung Kerinci, the highest volcano in Indonesia, because I already complete my second and third volcano, which is Gunung Rinjani, and then the Gunung Semeru. So I wish to complete the Gunung Kerinci as well. And then the last one would be quite expensive, which is the Mount Kilimanjaro, is the highest mountain in Africa. Yeah.
Okay. So Joanne, you mentioned about G7, you completed 4. So what's the last 3 remaining?
The Gunung Chama, Gunung Ulu Serpa, and Gunung Yongyap. You can see from the slide on the left, at the red color one, there are 7 highest mountain in peninsula, G7. Yeah. And then left the G5, G6, and G7. Yeah.
So are you going to climb the remaining G12? Because now there's G7 and G12. Are you going to climb the other G12 also?
Yeah, I hope to complete. I hope to complete all the mountain in Malaysia, actually.
Ah, okay. Nice. What about you, Rector? What are your future plan?
Yes, for the future plan, right? Actually, for the I have registered for the Rinjani run in Indonesia in 2019, but it was postponed due to the COVID-19. So I already paid the fee for this trip. So actually it's postponed 1 year by 1 year. So this year I also here received the email that is postponed to next year. So not sure next year if I can go there. So I'm also looking for some mountains in Indonesia or Malaysia. So as it's close to Singapore, right, it's a easy place for me to go. So I think after COVID-19 and when it's open, then I think may ask Joanne to as a lead to ask to visit the place in Malaysia.
Yeah, okay, go explore together then.
Yeah. So after that, right, actually I for Newport, also the Punhill, which is actually take 4 days, which is around 3,200 meters. Also I think it's not hard for beginner. So another one is the Everest, which is the top of the world that I cannot make it. But yeah, but I have planned for the base camp, which is EBC base camp, which is around 5,500 plus. It may take around 14 days to complete. So other than that, also some place in China, like the Shiguniangshan in Sichuan. Yeah, so besides hiking, right, I actually planning to take some running trip as well in different countries.
Oh, all right. So I noticed both of you mentioned the Everest, EBC Everest base camp. Is it the same as climbing the Mount Everest to the peak of the Mount Everest? Because I remember Mount Everest required some requirement or some, I don't know what lah, I heard from people lah. So can I hear from you guys? Is it the same?
No, it's totally different. The base camp is just a base camp. The altitude is about 5,300 meters only, but the Mount Everest is actually 8,800 something, right? So it's not only involved to the body fitness, stamina, all this, also include the budgets, which is travel expenses, license, insurance, equipment fee, and guide fee. Generally, it costs around USD dollar, 60,000, more or less. And then this cost is not include the few months training times and cost at the snow mountain, because you need to train yourself before you try to challenge the Mount Everest, and then some special equipment cost. So actually it's quite complicated if you want to challenge the Mount Everest. So I think I can only challenge it in my dream for now.
So Vector, are you planning to go conquer the Mount Everest peak in the future? If you have the chance.
For now I think I cannot make it. I can hear some people that they prepare for it for many years. So for me, compared to them, I just a beginner maybe.
Okay. So hopefully the pandemic over soon so you guys can fulfill your future hiking plan. Then maybe Vector, I heard that Malaysia is open and Singapore is now working on the vaccine passport, so you can travel to Malaysia to hike soon. I don't know. This is what I heard. So okay, let's moving on to the next question. I think this one most of us also want to know. What is the budget required to go hiking? Because I heard hiking required a lot of budgets since I heard from you guys. So I want to hear from you both. What is the budget required to go hiking? Joanne.
Okay, besides the equipment that you need to invest, like all this, all we mentioned just now, the backpack, clothes, all this, then there's something that we need to know also. Like in Malaysia, I don't think there's a standard budget, because we have some certain category. Like if you hike in a private land, which is there's a private owner, like Bukit Seri Bintang in Kepong, or the Sungai Long Hill in Semeni, the Bukit Taiso in Seremban, like this. All this actually basically is free, unless the owner is required tickets or something like that. Okay, so the second one is a park managed by the community. Definitely is free, like the Taman Tuku, Bukit Gasing, Bukit Kiara, Kota Damansara Community Forest, like that. So basically, you just need to do a simple registration at the entrance, then you can just go in like that. Okay, and then the third category is the National Park or Forest Reserve managed by the forestry. So this kind of mountain or hill, you need to apply a permit. So the cost usually between RM1 to RM5. So example, the Bukit Kutu, the famous one is Lango, the Gunung Nuang in Hulu Langat, Gunung Berembun in Seremban, Gunung Tahan in Pahang, Gunung Ledang in Johor, and then more and more. So basically, if you're hiking in Malaysia with under the National Park or Forest Reserve, then you need to apply permit. So for certain mountain like Gunung Tahan, you need mountain guide. Okay, and then the price is subjective because it's a sharing basis lah. Like let's say a mountain guide is cost you about 1,200, then it's sharing by 12 packs of people like that. So also sometimes you may need porter to help you to carry some stuff because it's a 7 days expedition. So and then the price is quite subjective also because one porter can carry about 25 kilo, then you can share with your teammate. So like let's say two people sharing maybe a few hundred. Yeah, and then more people sharing, then you have more, you have lesser budget for that. Yeah.
Ah, okay. So Joanne, one thing, one question. Is there any estimation, like if I want to go Gunung Tahan, I want to climb Gunung Tahan, is there any estimation of budget that I need, that I require, that I need to save up?
Depends how you go though. If you go under the travel agency, it may cost you thousand, it may cost you thousand, including all the fees like the permit, the guide, and then the portal, and then some food that you need to prepare, the sharing foods, because so many days you need to cook or need to bring up, and then yeah, the petrol, all this, yeah, maybe around 1,000, and then yeah, around that lah, depends on how many people you go, you know, because you can go by 5 people or maybe you can go by 12 people, so the cost may vary to the group of people.
Ah, I see. So, okay, what about overseas budget? Like, got any estimation I should save up? If I want to go overseas to climb?
For overseas, they normally involve like travel package. Usually, we will take travel package because they can help us to apply the permits and then arrange the guides and portal as well. So, for the budget, it depends on the country and currency. Like Indonesia, when I go to Rinjani, I can easily settle like about 1,000. Yeah, 1,000 plus like that. But to ABC, I actually spend about 5,000 like that. Yeah, so it depends on the currency. Yep.
Okay, all right. Okay, thanks, Joanne, for answering. How about you, Rector? What is the budget required to go hiking?
Okay, right. So for beginner, actually, there are a lot of places that is free of entrance or is very cheap, like less than 10 ringgit. So for the promo and agent, I have been to, so it's around 3,000 Singapore dollar. So it will be including the accommodation guide and park entrance fee, bus transfer. So just except the flight ticket, you will need to buy separately. So for Kinabalu, right, it's around 700 Singapore dollar. So it's same. It will including the accommodation and so on. So for foreigner is more expensive. So if you are local Malaysian, it will be cheaper. So for details to go to Kinabalu, actually you can go to the website and check. The website I think is the mountkinabalu.com. So So other than the trip fee, you may need to pay, right? So just now we have shared some of the items that we may need to prepare for this hiking trip. So you can see the PPT here. There are some brands for outdoor. So you can go to this shop to buy something you may need to prepare. So I think for you to start, you may start to buy a hiking shoe. So for me, my shoe is from the first one, the Salomon.
So this fall is what you recommend for for our viewers if they want to buy a hiking shoe. So which of these four is, how to say that? Do you think it's the best quantity at the best and the best price one?
I think don't have which one is best.
Okay.
It also depends on the shoe. How is it look like? Do you like this model? Is it very beautiful for you?
Okay. Thank you, Joanne and Victor. So now we talk about budget. Now I want to ask, what are some recommended locations to go for beginners? So like me, if I'm a beginner, so if I want to go hiking, so which location is best to go? Joanne?
I think you can start by easy hike around the Klang Valley, like Bukit Kiara, Taman Tuku, Bukit Kutu, Gunung Ulong Semangko, or Bukit Apek. So all this hill or mountain actually takes you about between 3 to 6 hours to complete. So I think it would be nice for a beginner. And then this hill or mountain actually located nearby the city, which means it's even much safer for beginners when you need any help. Okay. You can see in the slide. Yeah. Mm-hmm. All the beautiful place.
So each of these hikes had different view lah, because I see from all the slides is that what we expect to see different thing when hiking. Is it the truth?
Yeah, different hill or mountain will have different view. Some bukit you can see a very beautiful river stream, and then some mountain you can see a panoramic sky view. Yeah, so it's very challenging and interesting also.
Okay, so I heard that Bukit Apek now recently closed, not due to the FMCO, but because they charge money or something like that. Is it true? Because Bukit Apek is actually very near UCSI, so I want to ask about this.
I think it's only closed only due to some, last time was malaria is happened there, so they actually closed for some time, and then also some accident, and then also because of NCO. But commonly, I think it's open after that, beside MCO period lah. Yeah, I think now can go, but then yeah, there's a new rule supply. You need to apply permit for that.
I see. So for you CSI student, whoever want to go hiking or beginner hiking, you guys can recommend. There's one hill called Bukit Apek that is very near UCSI, so it's around 10 minute drive from UCSI, so it's actually very near, so you guys can just go there and climb. You guys can expect to see waterfall, and then I heard that you can connect to Bukit Saga also, if I'm not wrong. Is it true, Joanne?
Yes, it's actually side by side, Bukit Saga and Bukit Apek. You will accidentally cross it and you never know if you are not familiar with the hill. Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Joanne. So how about you, Rector? Location do you recommend?
Yes, so I think some of the, actually I'm not quite familiar with Malaysia. I think Joanne already explained some of the place in Malaysia that for beginner to start. So as I based in Singapore, I think I can introduce some place in Singapore if you are coming to Singapore. But actually, there are also not too many places to explore, like only the Bukit Timah in Singapore and Marriage Reservoir. So there are some that you can see the picture. There are some other places in Malaysia. So which is not for beginner, I think it's quite advanced. Some of these places I have been or I have never been, but I did some research before, which is my future plan as well. So for this Gulam Datu, actually I have been there, and this picture also I took it by using the drone. So from the drone you can see the full picture of this view, which is quite beautiful.
Things are getting better even when you feel like they're not. So hey girl, take a look around you, look at everything that you've got. And I know you've been in a scary place, but can I help you turn the page? Treat you how you deserve to be. Wanna be a part of your fantasy. Well, only if you promise me we'll keep the light on, light on, light on. The light on, light on. As you're leaving the light on, whoa. we keep it moving on. Whoa, with your light on. Whoa, it'll be right on. Don't go thinking that you gotta give up on. Everything is never enough. And I know you never felt this way. You've been all over the place. Am I the one you need to see? Cause I'll be there on the rainy days. And when the sky's turning gray, we'll keep the light on, light on, light on. The light on, light on, light on. It'll be right on, right on, right on. As you're leaving your light on, whoa, oh, oh, keep you moving on, whoa, oh, oh, with your light on, whoa, oh, oh, it'll be right on. Don't be thinking that I'm not understanding everything you see and you feel that you gotta be, cause I know this time. You'll be just fine if you just try. Leaving the light on, light on. Alright, alright, on. Just step on. Well, as you're leaving your light on, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. We keep you moving on, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. Leave your light on, oh, whoa, whoa, whoa. It'll be right on. Leave the light on, light on, light on. The light on, light on, light on. It'll be right on. Light on, light on, light on. Just step on.
Okay, so Vector, so just now that one is a video of you climbing Gunung Datuk.
Yes.
Can I know when is it? When you climb Gunung Datuk?
When or where?
When?
I think it's around 5 years ago.
Wow. Okay, good to hear. So the Gunung, this Gunung Ampak is also a place that you recommend to go for advance.
Yes.
Okay.
So the below is also some place you can try it out. I think you can judge it by the height of the mountain. I think 1,000 will be more difficult. Then you may try to do some around 500 or 600.
Like this Gunung Pulat is like 600 meters. So this Gunung Panti. So these two is more recommend if for after beginner level more like intermediate level. Okay.
Yes.
So, okay. Thanks for your answer, Rector. And one final question before we move on to the Q&A section. What are some advice or tips from you guys to beginner hiker or people who want to try hiking? So, Joanne, what is your advice?
So I say very important, never underestimate the mountain. Always well prepared by doing some research, because we often heard that some people stuck in the mountain and then get lost in the mountain or maybe get injured, this and that. So a lot of incident happens because of lack of preparation and underestimation. So what you need to do, always collect the info like the elevation, the distance, the duration, and check whether there's a water point, if any. This is to help you to preparing your backpack, especially the water and food storage. And you can also get some advice from the senior hikers to know how to prepare the things. And then always stand by some extra food and snack, because you can't know any accident happen like flood or rain or anything. So always remember to inform your friends and family about the activities, so in case any emergency happen, then they get alert on it. So this is very important. Yeah.
Okay, thank you for your advice. So Joanne, one thing. Do you always do research when you go climb different mountain? And where do you get all the research information from?
Yeah, I always study the mountain information because I need to get prepared. So sometimes I will get some advice from senior or those who been to the mountain. I will check on them, what kind of things I need to alert, what kind of thing I need to notice, and then how many water I can bring or food. Then I will get advice from them. Also, I will find some information on internet as well. So to check as much as many I can. That's why myself also prepare hiking blog for those people who need it. So this kind of information actually helps you to get ready for hiking. So I always encourage people to study and study, not just like ask on the internet and then get something mistaken information. Yeah.
So during the your hiking, you always go for senior advice. So where do you find all these senior?
Since I start hiking, like I already, I joined some hiking group, and then I know a lot of fans and friends. So this is my hiking network, I can say. Or you can actually join some Facebook group. There's a lot of hiking group in Facebook. Actually, you just try to search a hiking group or camping group or this, then you can try to ask inside also. But anyway, whatever answer they give, you can use it as a reference, but you need to find out also, you need to explore it, whether it's right or wrong. Yeah.
Mm, I see. So networking is important for hiking, lah, in the sense of course.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Thanks, Joanne. How about you, Vector? What are some of your advice?
Yes, for otherwise, right? I think for you, you may need to know aware of the place where are you going to. You don't just follow your partner, your buddy, but actually you will need to know the detail about it. So also, how is the weather like? So you know how much thing you may need to bring. Do you need to bring the clothing, the warm clothing? Do you need to bring a lot? So is there any water station that you can refill the water? As you know, the water is important to our daily life. We need to drink a lot of water for the body recovery. So I think for you to start, right, as what I mentioned, buy a trekking shoe and just start your mile step. To start, I think around 5 to 10 kilometer hiking route. So I think other than this, right, for my friend, as we previously went to the mountain, some of the one or two friends, they never hiking before, so for them to train themselves, they just climb the stair of the building near to them to train. So even bring the full package around, 8 km, just climb the stair of the up and down. Yes. So this is something you can just train yourself if you don't have too many places near you.
I see. Thank you, Rector. So train yourself is to train your stamina and energy. So when you do the physical hiking, you can do it very well, lah.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you, Joanne and Rector, for answering some of these 10 questions that we prepared today. So now we move on to begin answering the questions submitted during today's presentation, because I saw there's a few. So let's move on to the Q&A section. So for our first question, from I don't know who, he asked, is there any hiking group that he could join? And okay, so Joanne, right,
can we hear from you? As I mentioned just now, there's a lot of hiking group in Facebook. If you search like some keywords, hiking or camping, then you can easily find some. So I can suggest two of it. I think Hakam is the one of the biggest hiking group in Malaysia, which is Hiking and Camping Around Malaysia. The group name is Hiking and Camping Around Malaysia. I think this is the biggest hiking group in Malaysia, okay? And then the other one is Qu Pa San, Yu Qu De Qu Pa San. Then this group is quite famous also. So you might can join and then ask some questions and get some information from there as well.
So when you join these two groups, so maybe they will like, is there like, oh, they will say, I'm going to rent a hiking. Is there anybody interested to join? Is there some kind of question like this so people can like join it or something like that?
Yeah, actually, I join a lot of hiking group because it's my interest, right? So yeah, there's some of the group that actually will join party to go hiking. So you can actually ask when you want to go hiking, can I join? Or yeah, you can form a date or form a team like that in the group. So most of them actually quite okay to go together. Yeah.
So stranger also, they no problem one. So I went to meet there and then become friend.
Yeah, anyway, if you want to find friend or group in Facebook, just might take at your own risk anyway. They are okay actually, just need to filter yourself.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. So, let's move on. So, what about you, Vector? Do you have any recommend group?
Recommend group? I think usually I use WeChat. So, I think my group usually is from China. Yeah.
Okay. Thank you, Vector. So, next question. So, let's move on to the next question from today. I just now saw, guys, there's some technical difficulty at the moment. Give it a while.
Okay.
Do you recommend beginner hiker to buy hiking stick? Joanne.
Yeah, I think yes, because when I was beginner, I buy hiking stick as well, because it can actually help you to balancing when you go for a hike and then save your energy while hiking. And then it can also prevent fall down and avoid knee pain, this common issue where hikers actually facing. But yeah, depends on people. After that, when I use sometimes, actually things I can go hike with free hand. So I actually just don't use hiking poles right now. But for trekking like in Nepal, it's a very long days expedition. So I actually bring trekking poles. That's very important. So yeah, for beginner, I think yes. If you are okay to use it, then you should have it.
How about you, Vector?
Yes, I think it's important. Even not for beginner, even advanced, even you have experiment. So in some place, you may need to bring it. So it can help you to reduce some pressure on your knee as well, other than what mentioned by John just now.
So yeah, I saw before there's a different type of hiking pole. Am I correct? Because I know there's some that can string and some that is just like one whole stick. So which one do you guys recommend the most?
I think there's few kind of hiking pole. Some we can actually extend longer, and then some can actually two-fold or three-fold like that. So depends how you want to carry. I think the two-fold one is quite good, but actually you have to see the materials. Yeah, there's different of the material of the hiking pole. So you have to you can maybe get advice from the shopper. Yeah.
So Vector, how about you?
Yes, for the stick, right? Actually, you will need to adjust based on your height. Yes, so I recommend you to buy the 可以伸缩那种.
the one that can extend.
Yes.
And actually, there's also different handle for the hiking pole. Some one kind is like the straight one, and then the other one is like a T-shaped one where you can actually hold like this. Yeah. So you can choose which one is most suitable to you. There's no 每一个固定的一个条件，就是你 when you know which one is suitable, then you just get which one. Some people like the T-shirt one when you can hold it like this, especially when you descend from the mountain. And then some people they like the straight one. Yeah, easy to keep on your backpack. Yeah, so it depends on you.
Okay, thank you. So is actually recommended lah for hiking pole for beginners. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. So let's move on. The next question. Is there any permission we need to apply for before we go for hiking overseas?
Vector?
Okay. Yeah. For Kinabalu, right? Actually, you can search from their website. Actually, they have some different package for like Kinabalu, they also 2 days trip, 3 days trip. So I think when you buy the pack, because they have, as I remember, they have limit as well. So for example, this day they have only 50 slot. Then it will open to the public to put. So for Kinabalu, right, actually the guide is necessary. It's mandatory. You will need to hide the guide for you. So it's around 1 to 4. So which means the one guide can lead 4 persons or 6 persons, I cannot remember. So when you buy the package, it will include all the entrance fee. They will apply you for the entrance as well.
How about you, Joanne?
Yeah, for overseas hiking, right, normally they include in the package because we always take some package from the travel agency or we search online. So normally they include the permit, the portal, and the mountain guide. Yeah, so that's why they will check on you how many people in the group, how many portal you need, then they will give you a quotation. Yeah.
Buy hiking stick. Ah, Joanne.
Yeah, I think yes, because when I was beginner, I buy hiking stick as well, because it can actually help you to balancing when you go for a hike and then save your energy while hiking. And then it can also prevent fall down and avoid knee pain, this common issue where hikers actually facing. But yeah, depends on people. After that, when I use sometimes, actually things I can go hike with free hand. So I actually just don't use hiking poles right now. But for trekking like in Nepal, it's a very long day's expedition. So I actually bring trekking poles. That's very important. So yeah, for beginner, I think yes. If you are okay to use it, then you should have it.
How about you, Becker?
Yes, I think it's important. Even not for beginner, even advanced, even you have experiment. So in some place, you may need to bring it. So it can help you to reduce some pressure on your knee as well, other than what mentioned by John just now.
So yeah, I saw before there's a different type of hiking pole. Am I correct? Because I know there's some that can string and some that is just like one whole stick. So which one do you guys recommend the most?
I think there's few kind of hiking poles. Some we can actually extend longer, and then some can actually two-fold or three-fold like that. So depends how you want to carry. I think the two-fold one is quite good, but actually you have to see the materials. Yeah, there's different of the material of the hiking pole. So you have to, you can maybe get advice from the shopper. Yeah.
So Vector, how about you?
Yes, for the stick, right? Actually, you will need to adjust based on your height. Yes, so I recommend you to buy the 可以伸缩那种.
the one that can extend.
Yes.
And actually, okay. There's also different handle for the hiking pole. Some one kind is like the straight one, and then the other one is like a T-shaped one where you can actually hold like this. Yeah. So you can choose which one is most suitable to you. There's no 一个固定的一个条件, 就是你, when you know which one is suitable, then you just get which one. Some people like the T-shaped one when you can hold it like this, especially when you descend from the mountain. And then some people, they like the straight one. Yeah, easy to keep on your backpack. Yeah, so it depends on you.
Okay, thank you. So it's actually recommended lah for hiking pole for beginners. Okay.
Yes.
Thank you. So let's move on. The next question. Is there any permission we need to apply for before we go for hiking overseas?
Rector?
Okay. Yeah. For Kinabalu, right? Actually, you can search from their website. Actually, they have some different package for like Kinabalu, they also 2 days trip, 3 days trip. So I think when you buy the pack, because they have, as I remember, they have limit as well. So for example, this day they have only 50 slot. Then it will open to the public to put. So for Kinabalu, right, actually the guide is necessary. It's mandatory. You will need to. You will need to hide the guide for you. So it's around 1 to 4. So which means the one guide can lead 4 persons or 6 persons, I cannot remember. So when you buy the package, it will include all the entrance fee. They will apply you for the entrance as well.
How about you, Joanne?
Yeah, for overseas hiking, right, normally they include in the package because we always take some package from the travel agency or we search online. So normally they include the permit, the portal, and the mountain guide. Yeah, so that's why they will check on you how many people in the group, how many portal you need, then they will give you a quotation. Yeah.
So there is no like very strict requirement lah.
No, it is included. It is a must to apply the permit, but usually the travel agent or the mountain guide, they will prepare for you for overseas hiking. Yeah. So it's easier for you because we are foreigner. We don't really know how to apply or maybe spend a lot of time. Might as well we use that time to explore the city.
So all the permission, all that, you guys can check online and then just give it to the travel agency to apply.
No, you check the hiking package or the hiking tour package from the internet. You can find from travel agency or any the travel agency, and then they will actually arrange for you everything.
Oh, all right, thanks. Yeah. Okay, so move on. What is the from Sashi Kuma? What is the best season to hike Mount Kinabalu? I heard that both of you guys already hiked Mount Kinabalu. So what is the best season to hike?
Okay, generally the locals will recommend around March to September because of the dry season. So during these months, the weather is usually very nice with a low chance of rain to come down, because if you hike under the rain, it's quite dangerous also. So it actually takes the perfect time to conquer the Mount Kinabalu. But I also, when I go on May, which is the best season as well, but it also rains almost every day. So it's very depends on your luck, actually.
So Vector, how about you?
Yes, best season as what mentioned just now by Joanne. So for Kinabalu, right, actually different season they have different price as well. So if you are going on a different like 比较少人去的时候, then we will cheaper than the different season.
Seriously, Mount Kinabalu has less people.
I don't know. It's up to you. I don't know. I didn't really go hiking, so I don't know. But
usually you need to book it in advance. If you want to go Kinabalu, you usually need to book in advance about 2 or 3 months ahead. Yeah, usually but because of the pandemic, I'm not sure how it is now. Yeah.
So different season also got different view, is it?
The view is the same, just whether you are lucky to see the sunrise or the clear panoramic view, whether the weather is with clouds or raining or that. Yeah.
I see.
So of course the dry season will be the best. You can see the very clear view of the city of Sabah.
Okay. So let's move on to the next question. Power bank is equally important too, right? Here from both of you. So do you think power bank is equally important for when hiking?
To me, depends on how you use the phone, I guess. Because for some heavy user, they actually use the phone to taking photo or video. If you take a lot, then yes, the battery will drain fast. So usually when I bring my mobile device, I actually put flight mode. So it can actually save my battery. And then because I have a separate device for photo and video shooting, so I don't really need my phone. So for day hike, usually I don't bring power bank. Yeah, but for camping, of course, because we will go for overnight. Yeah.
So how many power bank you bring? One or two?
Depends on my device. Like when I go to Gunung Tahan, it's about 7 days expedition. So I bring 2 power bank if I'm not mistaken. Yeah.
So Vector, how about you? Do you think power bank is important? 充电宝?
Yes. For me, actually, I power bank is the must that I bring along for my, as I taking some, I will take a lot of video. So other than power bank, right, actually I will charge all the charger for my camera as well. So it's not just bring one battery for the camera. I will bring what I have, or 2 or 3 power bank, and charge it, the charger, the battery. So for power bank also, at night then I will charge it to full, in full.
All right, thank you both of you. So power bank is important too, so for all the participants to know. So depends on how many days or what the trip you go. Okay, so for our next question on the Q&A, what is the cost for EBC? this is a very interesting question that I want to hear too. So I heard that both of you is trying to go. So what's the cost?
Okay, based on my friends going last time, I think 2 years ago, like 2019, the cost is around 6,000 all in, including the flight, accommodation, the transport, and the permit, mountain guide, all this lah. Because it also depends on what kind of package you have taken, like which route you are going. There's a short and long trail, like taking 10 days, 18 days like that is very different. And then what kind of food and service you need, how many porter or guide, and then you need to give some tips or so. So it's around 6,000, I would say.
Around 6,000. Vector.
Yes. How about you? I think, yeah, as what mentioned just now. So it also depends on how many days you may stay. So for EBC, right, actually around 14 days, but actually you may take less than that or more than that. So if less than that, the lead may bring you to a higher start point. So you don't need to start from the lowest location. So actually it saves you some time that you may stay.
Ah, I see. So it depends on the day you stay, and then also the currency, the rate of the currency lah. So so the price isn't very that, so it's very hard to set an estimation of. But you also have to see. Okay. So yes, there's another question. What should I do if my friend is scared of hiking?
Okay, interesting question. Yeah, when you say scared of hiking, is before hiking or during the hike? So if you say scared before hiking, then better just leave him alone. Yeah, don't show him to hiking, I would say. But okay, if you are scared during the hike, then you need to always accompany he or she. So that's why we always have a buddy system, which means when you go to hike, you always have a companion to you, at least two people in a team like that. So to take care of each other. So in case you have emergency, to avoid get lost, all this. So if you're scared, then yeah, the other one have to be brave enough to guide the person and bring him or she to get out from the mountain safely. Yeah.
Vector.
I think I want to ask him why scare first.
Yeah. Good question. So before that.
If you scare, right, I think you can just take some very simple one or easier place to just try first.
Okay. So what if doing hiking? Like maybe you guys climb under the peak and then he said, "Oh, I'm very scared to climb down. What happened?" I don't know.
Then you need to help him no matter how. Yeah, no, I leave no one behind. That's why we always say, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. So let's move on. I heard there's a few more questions. So what can we do during the hike when it is raining? Yeah.
Put on your raincoat or windbreaker.
Isn't it dangerous to hike during that time? Because the floor will be slippery and everything.
Yeah, if it's already on the trail, it's during hiking, then you can't do anything. Either you need to descend as soon as possible. Like, you need to get away from the mountain as soon as possible because the trail will become muddy or slippery. And then if the mountain has a river crossing, then you will have the chance of flooding also. So if raining, like small rain, then it's fine. But if like heavy rain, then you need to judge based on the situations. Like, there's no confirmed answer for that. Yeah, you need to base on your experience as well.
Vector.
Yes, I think you put on your raincoat. That's why you may need to bring it. So other than raining, so 如果有雷电的话, 你就不要站在树的下面, 有可能会被劈中。
Okay, so let me translate what Vector just now said. So if there's thunderstorm, don't stand below a tree or not the thunder strike the tree and then it will hurt you and something like that.
Yeah, put on the raincoat is actually very important to keep you warm, actually, because when you get cold and the wind blowing, you will get you are wet and then you will get sick. So this is not good for you, lah. Mm.
So you don't want to get sick during hiking, lah, or not? You will be.
Of course, yeah. Because yeah. Hiking is a very active is a very healthy sport, right? You don't want to get sick after that, right?
Okay, thank you. So next question will be from. How to choose hiking shoe for different situation, and I think that different situation require different hiking shoes. So how do you choose?
Okay, there's a lot of people actually has mistaken on choosing a waterproof hiking shoe, but actually I don't recommend it for waterproof hiking shoe in Malaysia because Malaysia has a lot of forest or jungle that actually has river crossing or stream, so your shoe actually will get wet easily. Even though if you wear a waterproof shoes, but you can't really make sure he can stay dry all the time. Sometimes raining or you're sweating, the water is to go into your shoe also. So if it's a waterproof, then it will actually the water or the wet stay in your shoe. So that's not good actually. You can't feel comfortable. So to me, I will choose those fast dry hiking shoes, which is usually lightweight, and then it can actually dry out fast.
Vector, how about you?
For me, right, for hiking shoe, actually I choose the one that 高帮, 怎么说啊?
High arch.
Yes, so it will be good for you to protect your foot.
No, but actually because in Malaysia, Malaysia has a complicated trail, so sometimes we need to go up the siepo, you know, and then go up the low and then climb down from the xianya. We need to use some rope climbing, all this. So actually, our ankle will actually bend quite seriously sometimes. So, if you wear those gaobang鞋子, actually sometimes will
high arch shoe.
Yeah, sometimes will cause you cramp. But then for trekking like in Kinabalu, because it has a very clear path and rough, and then or even though to overseas like Nepal, ABC, all this, you can wear that because it can really protect your ankle. So subject to the place you want to go. But in Malaysia, I will say in Malaysia generally wear the low cut one. I will say that.
Okay, back to you want to continue just what you just said.
Yes, that is also something I want to say. So thank you for helping me.
Oh, okay. So I think there's no more question for the Q&A section. So thank you, Joanne and Vector, for your precious time today and sharing your hiking experience with us and answering some of the Q&A section that the participant had asked. And thank you everyone for attending today's webinar. So if you guys want to know more about hiking information and see more about Vector and Joanne hiking video or picture, do remember to check them out at their YouTube channel. Joanne's YouTube channel is Love Feeling, LUVFEELIN. I went to the YouTube channel, I saw the video, it's very interesting. You guys should definitely check it out. And Vector YouTube channel is 7 Adventure. His YouTube channel is also very good. You guys can, if I see his hiking video, I was like, okay, it inspired me to go hiking after the pandemic is over. Maybe I will go hiking, but I don't know yet. Okay. And also, you guys can check out Joanne Outdoor and Travel Blog at www.lovefeeling.com and her Instagram and Facebook.